Right, so plenty of headlines at this hour. First up, we'll get you all the action from Dalal Street, though. The Nifty saw a steady upward momentum through the day, ending above 11,500. The Sensex also gaining over 1%. Among broader indices, the Nifty Bank sizzled, with all 12 Nifty banks ending in the green. Mid-caps also rising over 1%, ending the day over 18,000. Surbhi is here with a detailed analysis of the day's trade. Surbhi.
It's a serious and a heady bull charge on Dalal Street. And now the Nifty is within kissing distance. I mean, really less than 200 points from its all-time highs. What a day we've had today. The indices ending at the day's high, and buying spread across sectors, buying spread across market capitalizations. The mid-caps had a great run. The Nifty Bank was outperforming. And of course, the Nifty and the Sensex also. Sensex, 400 points. That's the kind of day we've had. Let me quickly come down to stocks. The winners of the day included many financial names. Indiabulls Housing Finance, a 9% up move on that stock, and what a recovery from the lows. Zee Entertainment found some traction once again. Adani Ports was up and about. And if you talk about talking about other winners, in HCL Tech, there is a brokerage upgrade that came in that the market took note of. UPL, and then the banks. You know, let me talk about the banks in some detail. Yes Bank, Axis Bank, definitely higher. If you're looking at fresh 52-week highs today, in fact, Axis, State Bank of India and ICICI Bank, the trio of corporate banks have hit fresh 52-week high levels. That's the ferocity of this up move. If I talk about some stocks on the other side, then commodity plays like ONGC, Vedanta, Hindalco, these were stocks, Tata Steel, these were stocks that were on the lower side of the screen. And autos are a different story. I mean, here the sell-down simply continues. So names like Hero Moto, Aisha, Bajaj, they were once again on the weaker side. Now let me come to the mid-cap market. Very strong breadth, lots of participation. Some of the winners of the day included DHFL, Dish TV, HEG and Graphite, and even it actually managed to buck the trend over here. PSU banks, again, a stunning rally. So it's not just an SBI move, it's across the sector. Bank of Baroda, Canara Bank, IDBI, Allahabad, all of them up and about. The only stock worth pointing out on the negative side in the mid-cap market is Jet Airways, which finally was cooling off after a big, big rally. But what a month it's been. Let's see if we can sustain this tomorrow.
Right, Surbhi, many thanks for taking us through all the day's market action. So there you have it, bullish, heavy bull trade on the Dalal Street today. And moving on to the other big story that we're tracking, after taking control of Jet Airways, lenders are now busy finding a new buyer for the airline. Sources telling CNBC-TV18 that TPG and Etihad Airways are showing interest in bidding for Jet Airways. Ritu Singh is here with further details from there. Ritu, what are you picking up?
Well, you know, with less than 2 weeks to go for all the players to submit bids or expressions of interest, rather, to acquire Jet Airways, we're given to understand that at least three players have shown initial interest or initiated talks with lenders, in their interest in Jet Airways. First, of course, is Etihad itself, and this is a surprising one, given that Etihad had earlier conveyed its intention to exit the airline completely. But now we're given to understand that with Naresh Goyal out of the picture, Etihad is looking at acquiring a further 37% stake to take its stake up to 49%. Remember, currently Etihad, has 24%, but once the share capital of the company is doubled, Etihad's stake will fall to about 12%. And with an additional 37%, they will be able to take substantial stake in the airline. The second name that is, we've been able to confirm from the bankers is TPG. Now, TPG is a private equity player with interest in the aviation sector, but they are likely to bid, if they do, in partnership with another strategic player or fund. And the third player is NII, which, remember, was initially part of the resolution plan and was expected to pick up about 20% stake in the airline. But now we're given to understand it may even partner with another player once it submits those EOIs. And the 9th of April is the day to watch out for. Tata's, of course, has been the name doing the rounds. But as far as we're concerned, bankers have confirmed to us that they've not directly approached the lender so far. So it remains to be seen if indeed they do submit a bid by the 9th of April.
Right, Ritu. Many thanks for joining us with all the details from there. In fact, the other story that we're tracking, the Divan Housing stock was buzzing in trade today. That stock rallying over 9% after CNBC-TV18 reported that Piramal Enterprises could be closing in on a deal to pick up some equity in the company. Abhishek Kothari is here with all the details from there. Abhishek, how close is Piramal to sealing the deal and what's the rationale here?
Well, there is some time, Arif, before this deal actually materializes. Now, Piramal Enterprises may consider being a strategic investor in DHFL or Divan Housing Finance. Why am I saying a strategic investor is that they are looking to pick up some equity stake in DHFL as well as picking up some retail portfolio or retail assets of DHFL. So the stake buy, that is equity stake buy as well as asset buy, actually is a huge quantum on which Piramal is working out in terms of various resources of gathering funds. So what we understand is that if you take 100% as the acquisition cost, 85% will be given to asset buyout or buying out the retail portfolio of Dewan Housing Finance, while 10 to 15% of that money would go into buying equity stake in the company. So if you look at historically, Piramal has always invested with a board interest in board seat in mind. So they have picked up in the likes of Shriram Group as well, wherein they have a board seat. So Piramal may consider, some stake sale in some of the investments that it has done, and will partner with a private equity player to bring in or pull in the funds. The due diligence on DHFL has already been done by Piramal. Today, both Piramal and DHFL have given clarification to the exchanges. Now, Piramal Enterprises says that, no proposal has been given to the board yet. And DHFL as well has mentioned, there is no further improvement to the strategic investor that they spoke earlier in the con call on 4th of Feb. So, nothing yet to be disclosed because nothing has been taken to the board. So, both the companies saying nothing has been taken to board, and that is why, there is no clarification which needs to be given to exchanges. Back to you.
Right, Abhishek. Many thanks for joining us with all the details from there. And moving on, former RBI Governor Raghuram Rajan has confirmed that the Congress Party consulted him on its promise of providing minimum income support for the poorest 20% in the country. Speaking to Shireen Bhan, Rajan said the cash transfers could work as a solution, with both the BJP and the Congress taking that route. Let's hear out what he had to say.
But did you have anything to do with the Nyay scheme that's being proposed?
I talked to people in the Congress. Of course, I've spoken with Mr. Rahul Gandhi. I've spoken with former Prime Minister Manmohan Singh, with Mr. Chidambaram. I give them my views on many things.
Specifically on this scheme as well?
I have offered my views on this scheme also, yes. Both the Congress and the BJP have been quite firm in saying that targeted income schemes, targeted income transfers, are the way forward. And I think there's reasonable agreement that empowering people with cash transfers can be a very positive step. And to the extent that you can do that within the budgetary space and by eliminating distortionary schemes, I think that it is well worth thinking about. I think on the BJP side, we have the transfer to farmers. And I think we have the Nyaya scheme being proposed on the Congress side. Now, I think the key, of course, is to make it work. Which means that it has to be a way of, when I say empowering, not just empowering them today in choices, but creating a platform for them to become regular contributing members of the workforce. And how do you do that, whether it's agriculture or whether it's these direct transfers to the very poor? How do you identify the poor? My sense is what the Congress is saying is that this will all be laid out. We will figure out how to do it. And, they've proposed a committee, pilot projects, and a phased out process.
Well, now, despite Anil Ambani's Reliance Communications paying 576 crore rupees to erstwhile partner Ericsson to avoid a jail term, the drama is far from over. Now, today, Reliance Communications moved the Supreme Court, withdrawing a petition it filed opposing Ericsson's move seeking insolvency proceedings. Now, that move comes after the company law appellate tribunal had said that Ericsson may have to refund the 576 crore rupees if insolvency proceedings are triggered against Reliance Communications. Now, Ericsson is opposing the move, terming it mischievous. Ashmit Kumar is here with all the details from there. Ashmit, yet another twist in that, in what appears to be a never-ending saga between the two companies.
Indeed, it seems to be a never-ending saga. Even despite having made the payment to Ericsson as per the Apex Court's contempt order, it seems that the battle is far from over. What we now understand is that ARCOM, as it had initially said, that it will be looking to start IBC proceedings. The route that ARCOM has taken as of right now is to withdraw its petition, in which it had opposed Ericsson's plea seeking IBC proceedings against ARCOM. That's the method that they've adopted. Now, this is something that Ericsson has an objection to. Ericsson's position is that their entire plea, given as how Ericsson views have now been satisfied. There is no need for that petition to continue, for that elections petition to continue, and that it should be quashed, and that if RCOM is seeking IBC proceedings, they should move independently of the election petition. Having said that, off the record, what the councils tell us is that they are apprehensive that this proceeding, if allowed, if IBC proceedings are allowed under the election application, there could be a case of Ericsson needing to refund the money. And that is along the lines of the observations that had been made by the NCLAT. So that is the cause of concern here. Ericsson has termed it mischievous, not bona fide, this petition for withdrawal, as has been put forth by RCOM. The Apex Court right now has resisted passing any orders and has sought replies from both the sides. The matter will be heard in 2 weeks, but clearly the last word in this case is yet to be had. Back to you.
Right, Ashwin. Many thanks for getting us all the latest from there. So there you have it, the Ericsson versus Reliance Communications battle still raging on in the Supreme Court. Now, the current financial year is set to come to an end, and with that, it's time for the Income Tax Department to announce its plans regarding the IT return forms. Sources tell us that the tax man is set to introduce new forms incorporating changes for new elements that were to be unveiled in Budget 2018. Timzy Jaipuria is here with all the details from there. Timzy, the new forms coming in for the new assessment here?
Well, that's right. Come April, government will get engaged in asking over 6 crore taxpayers to file their income tax returns for income earned in financial year 18-19. Well, sources indicate that the Income Tax Department is currently designing the new forms, which are likely to be introduced around April 10. Here are some of the new changes that will feature for the first time in the ITR forms. New additions include: individuals will have to list capital gains made from listed entities. Government will charge 10% on gains of more than 1 lakh rupees earned. This is for both corporates and individuals. New window will also feature in for individuals where standard deduction up to 40,000 to be made available for the first time. Similarly, a new window on tax exemption for interest income from savings bank account of up to 50,000 rupees for senior citizen, and for non-senior citizens, the similar exemption will be available up to 10,000 rupees on the interest income earned from saving bank's account. A new window of 5% relaxation on capital gains if property is sold below the stamp duty. Let me remind our viewers that the return filing process usually starts in April and ends by 31st July. So let's see how are the new forms looking, and yes, we'll keep you posted on it.
Right, Timzy. Many thanks for getting us up to speed with those developments. So there you have it. The new forms are likely to be out by April 10th. And the Reserve Bank of India's Monetary Policy Panel is set to meet on the 2nd of April for its two-day policy meeting, and it is expected to announce its rate decision on the 4th of April. Now, the MPC is meeting against the backdrop of the third quarter GDP data, which showed that India's growth has moderated to 6.6%, which is the slowest pace in 5 quarters. Now, as those growth concerns weigh, the clamor for a rate cut is growing as well. In fact, 4 out of 5 members of the CNBC-TV18 Citizens Monetary Policy Panel, they have voted in favor of a rate cut ahead of the RBI's rate decision next week. Let's hear out what they have to say.
First, that question to you, Sajid, the cut or pause, and if it's a cut, how much?
25 basis point cut in our view.
Okay. All right. Okay. We need to see your board as well. Saviran, what are you expecting?
25 basis point rate cut.
Okay. Sonal?
Yeah. 25 basis point rate cut.
Okay. Fine. Shaumyo, what are you expecting?
We're expecting a 25
basis cut. Okay. Chairman, sir, would you disagree?
Yes, I would.
Yes. Okay. Well, the chairman has a reputation of calling the market, calling the MPC right in the past, even when he is in the minority. Sajid, how many rate cuts are you expecting through 2019? Counting April, 25, 50, 75?
Yes, including April, it would be 25, at most 50 basis points.
Okay. Well, Samiran?
It's 50.
50 basis. So April and one more cut. Yes. Sonal?
50 okay. basis points.
50 and one more cut in the future. Shaumyo?
50 BPS, but okay. with the possibility of an upward bias if growth doesn't pick up.
But you are expecting the 50 to come on April itself?
That will depend on the rate stance.
Okay.
So that's then.
Dr. Sen, how many basis points will rates fall in 2019? 50 basis. Okay, there is unanimity over here that a half a percentage point rate cut through 2019 only on April 4th itself, 4-1, the expectation is of a 25 basis cut.
Right, so 4 out of 5 people on that panel expecting a 25 basis points rate cut from the RBI. Well, now, Prime Minister Narendra Modi addressed a massive rally in Meerut in Uttar Pradesh today, where he lashed out at the opposition by calling them Dagdar. Highlighting the success of Mission Shakti, the Prime Minister has also gone on to say that his government was decisive and promptly conducted surgical strikes on land, sky, as well as space. Now, attacking the opposition further, he also added that this time the contest is going to be between a decisive government and an indecisive past.
जमीन हो आसमान हो या फिर अंतरिक्ष सर्जिकल स्ट्राइक का साहस आपके इस चौकीदार की सरकार ने दिखाया है जब मैं बैंक खाते खुलवाता था तो बड़े बुद्धिमान लोग भाषण करते थे कि देश में बैंकें नहीं है गांव का आदमी क्या करेगा ऐसा कहते थे कि नहीं कहते थे और आज वही कह रहे हैं जो लोग अरे गरीबों का बैंक का खाता 70 साल तक नहीं खुलवा पाए वो कहते हैं तुम्हारे खाते में पैसे डालेंगे कोई भरोसा करेगा क्या अरे जो खाता नहीं खुलवा सकता है वो खाते में डाल सकता है क्या?
And the war of words continues over Prime Minister Modi's surprise announcement of India's anti-satellite missile test. After Mamata Banerjee and Sitaram Yechury, BSP President Mayawati has also accused the Prime Minister of violating the Model Code of Conduct. Meanwhile, reports suggest that the panel set up by the Election Commission to examine this issue may submit its report this evening. And veteran actor and former BJP leader Shatrughan Sinha will be joining the Congress party today. Sinha is likely to fight from the Patna Sahib constituency against Law Minister Ravi Shankar Prasad. Now, while attacking his former party, Sinha said that there is no democracy in the BJP and the party functions under the dictatorship of Prime Minister Modi. He's also further added that he has always admired the Gandhis and believes that they are the true nation builders. And Lok Sabha Member of Parliament and suspended Aam Aadmi Party leader Harinder Singh Khalsa joined the BJP today. Khalsa was previously elected from the Fatehgarh Sahib constituency in the 2014 Lok Sabha elections on an Aam Aadmi Party ticket. But he was suspended by the Arvind Kejriwal-led party in 2015. And as we count down to the Lok Sabha elections, we at Network 18 urge you to exercise your right to vote. Here's a special presentation from our initiative, Button Dabao Desh Banao.
Democracy, a gift from our ancestors, bestowed upon us. It's time we honored it. As India gears up for the 17th Lok Sabha elections, it's time we joined the March of Democracy. It's time we came together as one nation. It's time we showed the world the strength of the largest democracy, our democracy. The ballot is stronger than the bullet. The indelible ink is mightier than the sword. Network 18 proudly presents Button Dabao Desh Banao, a campaign to empower you to make the nation of your dreams. To exercise your right at the press of a single button. It's time to exercise your voting right, for your heart beats for democracy. India needs you to come out and cast your vote. Ensure your name is registered with your electoral office or register afresh now. Button Dabao, Desh Banao, a Network 18 initiative.
And with that, it's a wrap on this edition of After the Bell. But do stay tuned to CNBC-TV18. Markets Today Talkback is coming up next.